She went.
No. No, but no. It's a person. He didn't melt.
I know.
There was no there was no melt of him.
No, he didn't melt. The carbonite melted.
But he thawed. You just said there's no difference between thawing. If somebody thaws, there's like a melt stage in between, but Han Solo categorically did not melt. There is a difference between melt and thaw. Otherwise, they wouldn't have two other words. I mean, separate words. There wouldn't be two words to describe the thing.
Hello and welcome to Because Money. Season 4, we're trying something a little different, and we are turning to you for support through Patreon. If you'd like to support Because Money, check out our page at www.patreon.com/becausemoney. That link will be below this video as well. And consider becoming one of our patrons. Patrons get access to behind the scenes clips, and if you give up to $10 an episode, you might even get a mystery craft lovingly made by Sandy's children. Today's episode represents the rarest of events. John, Sandy, and I were actually all in the same room together, like physically in the same space, and we got into this conversation about why we talk about money in the first place, why we think it's important, and how people can start having better conversations of their own. Naturally, that conversation gets into some pretty nerdy Star Trekian waters and ends with us trying to invent a game that may or may not become a national bestseller. I hope you enjoy dropping into our conversation.
Well, we recognize that there are shades of, there actually is not really any black or white. I'm borrowing completely from an earlier conversation, but if there are shades of gray, like on the spectrum of here's a decision, you could do any one of these things, and a lot of the reasons that you do it depend so much on your own personal values and constraints and all those things, then often what's presented to us is the final part of that. So somebody has painstakingly put together a really long blog post or a manual or like, I don't know, a CFP exam, whatever that is, and like they've done all that stuff. It's not that they didn't happen, but by the time they got to the end, now it's just the answer. And you don't, and often it's like that. It's like that comic where you say, like, oh, I'm totally successful, but let's not talk about all those other things that failed. That's not actually the punchline because I don't replicate punchlines.
Watch out, comedy world. You're come Sandy.
But if people had a chance to hear the way other people talk about the why they made their decisions and what they think about it, it might be totally boring and you might want to kill yourself. But on the other hand, it might be like, okay. That's interesting. I didn't realize that there was that way of thinking about it. I mean, every time we talk to you, I always come away. I come away with like, I should do that too.
This is the funny thing, because we've talked about a bunch of stuff today where it's like, I think we kind of made assumptions about how you guys handle things. You're like, oh, you probably do it like this. And you're like, well, actually, not at all. And you're like, this is the fun thing, because it's like, sometimes you're solving a similar problem. Sometimes you're not. Sometimes it's a variation on whatever that kind of like life financial problem is. But there are a lot of ways to get there. You guys are like this. I was in a bookstore the other day, and there's this awesome book about like things under the earth. And then you flipped it around, and it was things under the sea. It was for kids, but it clearly was also for amazing adults. And there was one whole page that was the evolution of the submarine. And so it like had the first ones, which is like, wooden with oars, but somehow they got it under the water, and then you have like versions of like a one-man submarine with like pedals and like this little thing that goes up, and then it goes down until you get like a U.S. nuclear sub at the bottom that's like, and it's an image that keeps on rolling around my head, so I'm like, we always look at the end, and we look at those first versions, and we're like, ugh, what an idiot. Like, you thought that was a sub, but that guy was under the water, like, in a boat that he made. And that's really cool. And, like, everybody has to follow a version of that. Like, a version of building your own sub. You don't get to just make the most advanced version that's ever been made. You go through a process. And, like, that's the thing.
And that's, you know, not to go into a side discussion on evolution and creationism and all that, but that's sort of the criticism of creationists sometimes come across as like, oh, well, what's good is half a wing, or, you know, an eyeball that's only got some of the parts. It actually is actually pretty good. And for everything that we have set our minds to as scientists to try to figure out how did this evolve, there's always an intermediate step that does add some sort of advantage. So that you can always sort of crawl your way towards daylight. but every little step you take gets just a little better, a little better. Sort of spiral your way up. So you look at this, and you're like, how did this ever form this like beautifully elegant, sculpted, aerodynamic form that's perfectly adapted to its environment? It's like, well, did it one step at a time.
Do you know what? So I've discovered this about myself in the past little while, mostly by working with my business partner, Julia. So she'll say, like, this is a thing. This is the way that we should do it. And I am like, oh, I don't know. Like, that doesn't really line up with, oh, man, maybe. You don't know this about me or whatever. So then I go back to, like, the hard way of doing things. Like, well, no, I'm going to build it from scratch. I'm going to do it this way. And then I kind of toil away at that. And I finally get to this realization where it's like, oh, she was right. That way is way better. But I don't know. I mean, now it's happened so often that it's just like, clearly, oh, well, obviously. But for a while, it was this real, like, self-awareness thing that, like, oh, I really like to figure it out. Like, I need to build the spreadsheet before I can trust what the financial planning program is doing, right?
Yeah.
You know, like, and now I can start to apply that understanding to other things. But the process of having to figure it out for yourself or to hear other people thinking about it or talking about it or whatever is, I have found that over the past couple of years to be actually quite valuable.
But I think it's like everything, it's this balance, right? It's this balance of saying you have to go through a process. So obviously there's lots of financial metaphors being made right now. It's just like you have to go through a process of wherever you are. Like, you don't get a jump to the end submarine. But also there's a danger in people in a little wooden submarine being like, no, mine is the best. And it's like you also have to look at other examples and see how other people are doing it in order to help you see that there's a better version to do what you're trying to do. You're like, oh no, what you could do is put on a huge metal armor suit that weighs 800 pounds and do it that way. And you're like, oh great, that's a better idea. And you try that and it seems insane. But like you go through the process and it's always this balance between being like, no, I'm allowed to go at my own pace and I need to see what other people are doing so that I get pushed a little bit and I get to challenge and say, you know, no, I need to do it my way for a little bit. Or that really is a better way. Maybe I should try it. And
that's don't have to reinvent the wheel.
Yeah, but at the same time, you don't have to like make your own Volvo, you know? You don't have to jump to the end. Like, you can make a wheel out of a willow branch at the beginning and then work on vulcanized river. It's not my best day.
We're getting there.
But like, that's the whole thing where conversations are really important and talking to people that do think differently than you. Just because there's maybe better ways to float 20,000 leagues under the sea than, you know, striking yourself in a bunch of armor.
Well, and you might not, the end goal, the highest and best use of a conversation might not actually be to do the thing the very best way. Oh, where am I going with this? It's coming.
Yeah.
It might not be like, okay, oh, now I have a better way to do it. But there's a best way to do it.
Yeah,
it might just be like, oh, that's the way you do it, and that's the way I do it. And
totally.
Well, and you know, we're people. We talk, we converse. So we don't have to have a conversation that does anything.
Yeah.
We can just talk. And,
what was the function
and,
of that?
And, you know, it could be like episode one, the episode about nothing, and no, we did not rip that last time. But it could just be that we're talking about something, you know, some money concept, and we're not coming up with a better way to do something. We're not coming up with a better financial plan or a better submarine or whatever.
Yeah.
We're just talking, and we're getting more comfortable with the one we have. It's like, oh, yes, okay, I've sort of taken my idea, I've shown it to the world, or at least to a couple of close friends. Maybe.
Yeah.
You like that?
Yeah,
good
idea.
Totally. I like that.
Because you're completely dumb, I'm a little insecure, and I'm a little more secure with it now. I've talked about it, and even just in the process of talking about it, even I just talk to the mirror, because I'm an introvert, do that. But
respect.
Even if I just do that and talk about it to myself, just sort of going through the motions of talking about it. Here's how I handle my money. Here's what I do in this situation. It just makes me more comfortable with it. And, you know, conversations about money are important, even if the conversation doesn't actually end up doing anything. You're just
I think I'm
more comfortable talking about money.
That's such a huge thing, and it's like that's one thing we talk a lot about today too. That idea that I don't know. It seems like the internet is all about trying to fix things and provide you actionable steps and hacks and all these kind of things, which is great. Like, I'm not saying that there isn't a real value for that, but sometimes exactly like you're saying, just being able to kind of be in a place where, like, we don't need to, there doesn't need to be a solution. There doesn't have to be anything that necessarily comes out of here. Just the mere fact of discussing it, just the mere fact of interacting, just bringing it out of the dark and kind of putting it out there and talking about it is a huge thing. Sandy's deep breath.
Did you read any Star Trek novels when you were growing up?
I still have at my parents' house a box of Star Trek novels.
Hold on, we're going somewhere.
No, it's just like, it was all Star Wars novels for me, and so now I feel like there's a distance between all of
those. I know, like, it's awkward.
Darmok and Jalad of Chandra.
Oh, good night. Okay. Wow, we're really digging in deep here.
Just full on.
So, this, I'm going to just, I'm sure it comes from somewhere else, but I remember clearly the moment where I was like, oh, that's the difference between empathy and sympathy, is the Star Trek Next Generation novel called Imzadi, or however you pronounce it, with Deanna Troi and Lieutenant Riker. Anyways, fine. It's okay, people, it's fine. But, like, the idea, so now I find myself so often telling, it's not necessarily about money, but it's about anything. Like, this is a thing I'm thinking about. It's good for me to try and articulate to other human beings, because that's clearly a challenge that I have, of just bringing language out and explaining something. But in the end, I always, not always, I frequently will tell somebody, like, look, I want to tell you this, and I want you to say, oh, that must be really hard for you, or that's really interesting, I had this experience. I don't need you to solve it. I just need you to listen and know that I have said it to you.
Yeah.
And that's a thing that I frequently with money, although you can't articulate it as like a value proposition in financial planning, like, oh, you will have told somebody something about your money and feel better about it in some warm and fuzzy way. But the truth is, speaking to somebody that isn't really going to be like, hey, you suck, you're totally wrong, and who's going to say like, oh, that must be pretty frustrating. I know where you're coming from. Or whatever.
And
it's pretty useful.
It is, and it's like, sometimes it's, yeah, I just get excited that you said useful and then I wanted to say it again, but you'd already said it. But it is actually useful. It's not just this, like, oh, sometimes we need, it's not just a feeling. Like, I had an email the other day, I had had, like, a short chat with somebody with my, like, weekly office hours, and she was like, even just the fact that I talked about it with you gave a huge burst of energy to just like, oh, right, that is something. But the fact that I made an appointment and we talked about it, all of a sudden it was like, oh, this is something that I really want to do, and gave like energy to that impulse, and just kind of like, just giving it attention. I'm just like one step away from talking about The Secret right now.
You really are. But it's okay. It's fine. We talked about anxiety, so.
Oh, no. I don't want to set up my camp in Star Trek versus The Secret. I want a new camp. It really is, like, it's not just a vague intangible that you can get really measurable, tangible results.
Okay, yeah, it's not useful in the sense that, like, it's utilitarian.
Yeah.
But it's a real thing.
But humans are not utilitarian. If we were trying to set up robots for financial success, and we're like, oh, your programming lacks cash flow and investment knowledge, here we're going to set you up, and it's, you know, going to take this long, and we know exactly how long it's going to take and exactly what the returns are going to be, then we just do that. And we come in, we fix you up. Okay, there's your little cash flow program. There's your little investing program, and, you know, maybe some insurance as a, you know, DLC down the road. And then you're off to the races and go.
I actually feel like you just described exactly what some of the traditional financial planning engagements have been in the past. Like, well, I will write you the program, we're going to plug it in your brain, and then you're fixed.
And if it doesn't work, restart your human, right, John?
Exactly, yes. Exactly.
Your human is clearly broken, restart your human.
What do you mean this plan doesn't work for you in your circumstances? You know, fix your circumstances, change your plan, change your life to fit this plan. And so, exactly.
Have you thought about getting married?
And so, quite often, what you need to do instead of just delivering the plan and giving a prescription and you know, this exact way to do it, is instead to have a conversation. The conversation informs, it's probably going to look somewhat similar to everyone's plan, because, I mean, the basics are really simple in terms of, like, spend less than you make, invest something for the future.
Yeah.
Have some trade-offs. But exactly what those trade-offs are, exactly what you're spending your money on, and the flexibility and the resiliency and everything that goes into that, there's lots of variation and subtleties there, and that requires conversation.
And fitting those, like, simple, yes, but sometimes simple gets interpreted in the wrong way, that it's easy, and I don't think that's what you're saying at all. But, like, it's it's one of these things where I really like the words kind of the fundamentals are basic has the same problems. They all have this connotation that it's easy to say, and it's actually extremely complicated to incorporate. And that gets to be your challenge. And people incorporate it in so many different ways, and that's fun. But that's your kind of responsibility. But you don't have to do that in a vacuum. And there's a conversation that you can have with somebody who works in finance, that idea of a planner, but there's value in every kind of conversation. Mm-hmm. There's value in a conversation that you have with your parents, with your friends. And it's kind of this indirect thing that the finance community keeps talking about, but then not really doing. We need to talk more about money. And they're like, and by that I mean my products. And you're like, it's such a limited conversation where it's like, we need to talk more about money, about whatever you want to talk about.
Mm.
You need to talk about the things that you want to talk about. And whether it's loosely associated with money or not, that conversation is going to have a ton of value for people. And that's one of the big things we've been kind of rolling over kind of back and forth today. That idea that just people, how can you actually encourage people and kind of facilitate people to have these conversations more with their partners? That's always a big thing. Just talking to a bunch of people over the last couple of weeks about how do you start that conversation mm-hmm. with your partner if you're not used to having that conversation? It's a big thing. You're planning together, but if you can't talk about it, then the plan doesn't matter. You don't have a functionality of being able to kind of spend the time and communicate. It's big. So it's like, what I always tell them is don't start with the loaded stuff. Just start talking about anything, talk about what you would do if you won $50,000 next week, talk about, a story of how you used to deal with Monopoly money when you were a kid, anything tangentially related helps make that conversation start flowing a little bit.
So don't start with you spent $8 on a Laserdisc thing that's never going to work. You're so wasteful.
Luckily,
maybe
that's not where you're starting.
Fortunately.
You have a long history of money conversations with that hypothetical example that definitely doesn't relate to your real life.
Not specific at all, no.
Specifically today.
No. Well, yeah, you could just have Mad Lib sort of. How do you get started? Or would you rather?
I like that. Would you rather is a really good idea. I keep actually meaning to. Maybe you guys can help me sometime. I really would love some money conversation flashcards to actually give to people to be just 20 non-stressful questions that you can just talk to your partner or talk to your roommate or talk to your parents about money. Because one thing I always try to stick out as an idea. This doesn't work with everybody, but just being like, if the only times you ever talk about money with people are stressful times, of course you're never going to want to deal with money. You're never going to want to talk about money. Because it's stress, money. We only talk about when there's not enough. When you only check your bank account when there's not enough. That's the whole thing. So it's can you create regular time? Whatever regular means to you. If you can do it every week, great. If that stresses you out, try every month. Try it every 2 months
Regular in terms of a regular schedule, but regular in terms of your life is normal. You're not talking to your friends or your family about, oh my God, I just got this job offer that I have to balance against this other potential way to go, or that's stressful, or oh, I'm in trouble this way and that's stressful, or I need to make this decision because there's a deadline coming up and that's stressful. Just when things are normal and quiet and peaceful and you got some time, you're up at the cottage and got nothing better to do, you're playing Would You Rather, and then I'd throw in some money ones.
Why not?
Would you rather have an extra $1,000?
Financial expansion pack for all of the games.
All
the
games,
Settlers of Catan. Financial expansion.
That one is financial enough. That one, the goods and services trading in that has ruined enough relationships.
Maybe Cards Against Humanity.
Super niche version. Oh, man. Just with Canadian personal finance terms. You can sell 5 copies.
Super 5.
We would share a copy, clearly.
Obviously.
So we would just have to sell more. It's a licensing deal right there. But I'm trying to think of more games that you play around. Would you rather, who would you do, financial version?
Well, maybe not who, but like what? Like, would you rather have more time with your family or more money? And that's sometimes an issue that will come up. And if you thought about it before you have the job offer.
Or even if it just, like you said before, you're talking about a conversation doesn't need to come to a conclusion.
Yeah.
It's like, just the question is interesting. You know, like, because people, when I hear that question, I'm like, okay, I would rather have more money so that I can spend more time with my family. And you're like, interesting, but I think that might mean that I could be caught in a loop, which I need to investigate sometime when we're not having a conversation about money.
Or what's your number? So, how much would you have to make extra to move to Yellowknife?
Yeah.
Oh, I really feel like there is a, obviously not a real actual like product, but that. Because I've always been, okay, so there, you know, there's people that I read who have a great idea, and I've always, Seth and I are always like, oh, we should do that. We talk about money all the time anyway, sorry, Seth, it's just life with me. But she does a regular money email. We had her on the show, Kristen, the frugal girl from like a couple years ago. Yeah. So she writes an email to her husband every month, because she's the one that does all the finances. So like, here's where we are, here's where we spend our money. I don't know everything that's in it, but this idea that like, okay, yeah, here's, it's just this template, and I just put these numbers in, and then we talk about, well, I cannot imagine that there are many people in the world where, number one, the activity itself would be interesting. It would be super interesting. The activity itself would be interesting. The conversation would be actually fruitful. And the person receiving it, if they're the person that has none of that information and now they get it all in one, I mean, it could be used. I mean, I'm sure it works for them. But this other idea, though, is way better because it's not this, let's look at graphs and spreadsheets. And it's much more about the things that the graphs and spreadsheets always have to support anyway, which is what are the things that are important to you? And you might think, I think you just mentioned it like 10 minutes ago, things that are really surprising about other people, like, oh, we agree on all these other things. Well, we're not at all the same in these other ways.
Totally.
And that happens with significant others and people.
And things change.
All the time!
You know, and I think even, like, not even about trying to keep pace with your partner or with your parents or with whatever kind of community you're talking about, but with yourself. Because sometimes you're not checking in all the time. I had a friend, I remember, I think he had just turned 30, it was a little while ago, and he was like, I realized that my life goals, I haven't taken them out since 20. Like, I'm carrying around the same life goals that I set for myself when I turned 20, and I just haven't dusted them off a little bit. And so that's part of the thing, too, and I think sometimes it's just nice to kind of hit it from the side and not be like, I'm going to sit down and figure out what my values are. You know, like, some people, I think, would really relish that kind of time spent alone, and some people would be like, sounds terrible. Like, that's... And so, like, just finding... The thing that the current, like, track that I'm on right now is really, like, create the time and then let whatever conversation happen. Just, like, if you can create and, like, be deliberate, if you're not used to it, be like, find 20 minutes, base it around something that you already love to do, go out for brunch, go for this is that classic finance thing, but just like, but don't worry about, you don't want to talk about your budget or you don't have one, just talk about, like, just put money as a thing, and just see what comes up, and it's like, be okay with that being like, we don't have to solve it all in 20 minutes, because we're going to do this again. We're going to do this again next month, next week, there's time for it, but it's just, I don't think that it happens right away, but I think over time, that then you at least have one of the biggest tools, space to have that conversation, so that you don't have to, like, it's not going to be, I don't know, that's the thing that's kind of in my head that, like, is one of the ingredients that could help do that, but it's not a one-size-fits-all thing.
We can talk about things that are uncomfortable to talk about.
Yeah.
And we need to do it, though, in order to get comfortable with talking about those things. And it's such an obvious thing, whatever.
No, but it's obvious or not, like, sometimes it's amazing how, sometimes you just have to name the obvious things, like, whether or not it's like, oh, of course I should know that, but, like, with, like, many of these things, he's like, oh, that's obvious, I'm like, oh, yeah. Yes, I should have definitely write it down. It's... This is why you have the conversations, because I think a lot of the time you can assume that you're on the same page.
Mm-hmm.
And you can assume that, you know, you understand what's going on, and that's often not the case, whether it's with yourself, And this is the thing too. Like, it's not just partner based or parent based or with. It's not just your money how it relates to somebody else. It's your money how it relates to you. And just using somebody as a sounding board can be a really valuable thing. And like, just anybody that you trust to be like, hey, so I do this. Think about that. You know, like, however, whatever that is.
Well, a lot of people, myself included, form thoughts as the words are coming out.
Totally.
So making the words come out is the first step to forming some extra thoughts.
Yeah, and sometimes when the words are here, then you can be like,
oh
yeah, I don't think that at all, but clearly some of me thinks that because it's said it.
I violently disagree with this part of me.
Yeah.
This fight with myself.
Yeah, no, it's true, and it's one of, like, it really is, I think, in, oh, man, when was it, when did I start the blog? It was like 3 years ago. Been the most value that I've gotten out of that whole experience is by publicly coming out that I was willing to talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people come up to you all the time, and they're like, hey, so, like, it's like money, right?
Mm-hmm.
And, like, they don't always have something to say.
Yeah.
But they just want to be like, I kind of want to talk about it, and I don't know what I, like, I don't have a thing yet, but it's like the starter point. They at least know somebody's open to that relationship, that conversation. It says conversation like 1,000 times, and I forgot the word.
That thing where people talk at each other.
But it really is, and they're like being able to get more comfortable, because I grew up not, we didn't talk about money at all in my house, so it really was a thing that was not... not something I knew how to talk about at all. And so, like, practicing that both with, you know, my partner, but also just with people that do things really differently, and it's not always super fun. Like, sometimes you're like, either, oh, that's so smart, why don't I do that, I'm such an idiot, or that's crazy, and then you go away and you're like, I see, like, it's hard to be challenged, but it's just also good, because I think that not talking about finance specifically can be really isolating. Like, it's such a common thing to talk to people who feel so alone in their struggles or their
shit together.
Like, seriously, and I carry that around, and I still have part of me that carries that around.
Oh, yeah.
Where it's just like, no, still, everybody has their shit together, and but not me, because, and it's, like, between you, me, and, you know, our lovely listeners, nobody does.
No,
right. Like, because it's a constantly evolving process. And
that's,
like,
exactly the... Okay, so look, sorry.
No, that's the perfect moment for you to...
The fact that it is constantly evolving is so uncomfortable, because we can only think in this... I'm conscious in this moment.
Yeah.
Whatever I said 3 seconds ago, that's not even me anymore. I'm me now. And now, whatever. We can do
Isn't that an Alice in Wonderland quote? Oh, shoot, there's a really great, like, I would tell you about who I was yesterday, but I'm not that person now, and it's...
That, right. What you said, that thing, and Alice, them, all those people. But that feeling of, because I have this, we've talked about, like, I've changed the infrastructure so many times, and it feels as though I'm changing, in my own personal narrative, it's, oh, you did it wrong the first time. And so now you have to change it because it's wrong. Because we have this idea, and especially as financial planners, we have this idea that we need to make the thing that will be infinitely flexible and deal with anything that could possibly happen in your life. Like, I can't even do that for myself. And I know myself way better than I know you, Mr. Client. But it's really uncomfortable to think that, like, okay, I'm putting all this work and conscious thought and conversation and just... I'm going to make the thing that works for me best right now, and a year from now, it's going to be all
You want something that sort of has a railroad metaphor. You're like, okay, I'm on the rails. I know right where this is going because I'm on the rails, and it's going to get there. And I just want to make sure that I'm on the right track to get to that location, not to the track that gets over there. And then I just need to keep steady on this track and whatever I need to do to feed my train and just keep it going. But it's never that simple. There's always switches and changes, and the whole thing evolves. Like, you know, just almost anyone's career path, right? Like,
but
someone is an opera singer and then starts becoming a financial planner on the side. And I mean, I was changing my career several times over through my education and life, because I started applying to university and undergrad for business because I had an interest in that, and that's also why I'm here, because I'm an pictures of money and stuff, ended up going into science. And then for a whole long period of my life, I'm like, I'm going to be a scientist. I'm going to, you know, get tenure and become a professor. And then opportunities and life events came up. And I'm like, okay, I'm going to change that. I'm going to go do this other thing. And then if another opportunity comes up in 5 or 10 years or next week or whatever it is, I'm going to consider that opportunity to possibly shift again. And until then, I'm on this track, and I'm going to continue as though I'm on this track, and I'm going to continue to be a, you know, scientific writer, editor, and keep going with that. But if something else comes up, I'm open to changing.
The thing that I find most interesting about that is because usually when we talk about this idea of, like, you make the plan, but life takes you in different directions. And it's this insinuation is like, the, you know, a boulder comes across the track, like something happens, something terrible happens.
Yeah. Sometimes it does.
Sometimes it
does,
but also sometimes you just choose that you're like, oh, I'm on the train to Montreal, but actually I want to go to Winnipeg, because Winnipeg's the
best. I don't even know that there was a switch that took me off in that direction. That sounds nifty. Let's see what
exactly goes on. Like, and that's the kind of thing where you're like, yeah, there's unexpected things that can drastically change your world in ways that you can't imagine.
Like, yeah, change can be bad, but change can just be neutral or good.
And but change can be from outer change and inner change. Mm-hmm. And like the thing is that I think that's another real service that having more conversations can do, and communication, because like that keeps you checking in with being like, you know, the 20 years, 30 year thing, being like, just, hey, I'm going here. I'm going here. I'm going here. Like, do I still want to go there? I think I still want to go there. Yeah, let's just keep, you know what, I'm not actually sure, but let's just keep pointed in that direction right now, and I'm doing it on purpose. And then, like, that's not how it always goes, because you still forget about things, but, like, you're more likely to catch it a little sooner if you're engaged in it a little bit.
It's the difference between goals and directions. Of course Sandy's going to agree with it, but, like, right, like, I want to be a X thing in X number of years, and it's going to take X resources and whatever. Well, sure, that can be a great exercise to, like, SMART goals or whatever, but, like, mostly I just want my life to be like this, and not even describing the outer life, I want to feel like my life feels like this. Internally, this is how I want to be, and the circumstances externally might change, but as long as they don't change so that this is all messed up, that is not a great way to explain it, but in my mind, it makes loads of sense. Like, I want to make sure I'm going in the direction that's going to allow me to do this or that or that. And if there are some financial choices that you can make for yourself, if we want to bring out to money, where you're closing off the options. So, like, the rent versus buy thing that I have not read yet, but I will have read by the time this episode airs. But, like, I'll be tomorrow. But, like, the idea that you, if you make that decision, you just need to know that some doors are closing, and that might be totally fine, and they might not be closing permanently. But the decision that you're making right now with this particular financial decision is going to allow for this range of things, but maybe you want this range of things, or this whole range of things, and you have to think about that when you make those decisions.
Mm-hmm. And I always think about, it's interesting how different people kind of relate to the idea of goals and direction or values. Like, different people kind of glom onto different words in different ways. How do you feel about the kind of specific goals versus value, like the kind of bigger, because I like the word values, I've always liked it, but I know that sometimes, like, when I talk to Mimi, my partner, she's like, the word values, she's like, that sounds like bullshit. Like, I hate, like, she reacts viscerally to the idea of being like, I just don't like that. Like, that's not a word. She would way rather think about goals, like specific, I'm doing this. And, like, I get that. Like, it really does, like, there's a brain working thing. That's just, you have to find the thing that kind of fits the best. And it all serves a similar purpose. But, kind of, there's an underlying fact. Oh, man, I'm massively uncomfortable with black and white facts. I feel like there's none of them in the world. But things change does seem to be a pretty
does
good
seem
one.
To be, yeah.
Maybe
I can go with that one.
One dude somewhere
unless
in the
you're
world.
Carbonite. Sorry. I messed up.
But I guess it can get melted.
But to circle back to goals, directions, values, there are a whole bunch of other words we can throw in there. Principles.
That's a good one.
And processes. And they all exist and interrelate to try to get you from where you're going. Where you are, where you're going, and how you want to get there. So,
do they all give you focus? Is that a fair thing to say?
Sometimes focus, sometimes it can broaden your focus, or broaden your what you're looking at. And they can also just change how you interact with the world and what you want to do with your life and how you want to live your life. So you can have your goal to be, you know, my goal is to go off and get a job at company X in position Y. I want to go, and that's my goal. And that might be over-defined because your goal might not be really that job title in that company. That might just be one step along the way. And if something comes up that violates one of your principles, like if you have a really sleazy hiring manager and they're like, oh yes, we'd love to give you this job if, you know, you would be willing to, and then, you know, bring your contacts from your old job or something sleazy in another way. And you're like, oh no, that doesn't fit with my principles. I'm going to go in a different way and, you know, reject that job and go somewhere else.
Yeah.
And then you can still sort of bring your life into a new direction, a new focus, if that opportunity is closed to you. Or if it's something that doesn't fit with another part of your principles, and then keep going. And then you can also think about how do you set up your life so that you can live by your principles, so that if you always want to have the freedom to leave a job, if you ever get pressured to do something illegal or against your principles that, you know, wouldn't normally be there, but if that extreme situation came up, that you would be like, okay, well, I've got the emergency fund and the security and the resources and the transferable skills and everything else, so just go off and take a new path, then you can.
The great place to start with all of this kind of analysis really is just to start to talk about it.
Mm.
You know, and it's like, it really is, and it doesn't have to be, you know, during a Twitter chat hosted by a... You know, like, it doesn't have to be in any kind of official financial sphere. It doesn't have to be to anybody at a bank. Just start talking about it to someone. Start talking about it to the person that you feel the safest with.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one thing that, you know, as we go about the season, we want to talk to you guys. And we want to, if you want to, we invite you to talk to us, you know, either by email or by direct message, or, you know, even to send us questions and maybe even join us in a conversation during an episode, if you're willing to do that kind of thing. It's really the idea behind expanding these conversations and having the kind of conversations that we have all the time. And we really enjoy and inviting you to those, but we're also really open to seeing what you talk about and what you would like to talk about more, and to seeing if we can all learn from each other. And that's really what we're thinking about a lot in season 4 of Because Money, and we're really excited about it.
I'm super excited about it.
All right, that's all we've got for you today. If you liked what you heard, head over to iTunes and give us a really good rating. That really helps people find us. That would be awesome. And if you loved what you heard, why not check out our Patreon page, patreon.com/becausemoney, and lend us a little support so we can keep doing what we're doing. I am Chris Entz, and you can find me over at ragstoreasonable.com. I'd like to thank my partners in crime, Sandy Martin, who you can find at Spring Financial Planning, springplans.ca, and John Robertson, who you can find Value It Simple or his blog, Blessed by the Potato, which is holypotato.net.
Goodbye.